Okay.
So I originally thought maybe I would have a presentation, and I decided that I wouldn't do that. And I was also told I had 8 minutes, and I'm going to try very hard not to use it, because I think it would be better to have a discussion. In order to focus on this relatively briefly, I'm going to focus on just one set of issues which are big enough, given the incredible list, and it isn't Brexit. So I'm very happy to answer questions about it, but I'm not going to talk about it because I'm unbelievably bored with this catastrophe. And I've written so much about it. So I'm going to focus on the Eurozone and its future after having survived this crisis, what lies ahead. And I suppose the main point I am trying to make is that one shouldn't put too much emphasis on what I think of as the centralized solutions of larger budgets, more active fiscal policy, greater fiscal transfers, any of that stuff. Because first, it's not going to happen. And second, it will remain a confederation of states largely responsible for their own affairs. And second, and even more important, and I don't want to make this point more than once, I think it will be incredibly damaging. I think of Italy as the paradigmatic example in the world of the problems that are created by permanent fiscal transfers. And you just have to look at what has happened in the south of Italy. And the Eurozone must avoid that at all costs. Countries have to own their futures. So we need to set up arrangements that are market-friendly, which deal with the main problems revealed by the crisis, that don't rely on these sorts of centralized solutions, that go with the reality that you have a currency union among sovereign states, at least sovereign, largely in terms of how they raise and spend money apart from fiscal deficits, which I'll come to in a moment. So that's the major point I want to make. It's obvious that, second main point, that the crisis was and has been a tremendous shock and in many ways a tremendous failure. In the sense that the Eurozone was not prepared for any such crisis. It took a very long time to work out what to do about it. And as a result, the Eurozone as a whole experienced what was essentially two crises when the US experienced one. There was a crisis in 2007 to 2009, and then another one which went on from 2010 up to 2012, early 2013. Since 2013, aggregate real GDP per head in the Eurozone has been growing as fast as that of the US, but of course it lost essentially 5 years. So in terms of the recovery, it's been in aggregate much weaker, and real GDP per head in the Eurozone as a whole relative to the starting point is much lower than it is in the US. Why did this happen? I think there were essentially four reasons. One, the countries went into the crisis in immense disequilibria. Two, it took a very long time for the ECB to work out what a sensible monetary policy response was. It finally got there, let's say, somewhere between 2012 and 2014, depending on which aspects you think are most important. And the result of this, so let me give you a very, very simple indication of the problem. If the ECB had been successful in keeping inflation close to but below 2% from 2007, the price level would now be about 7% higher than it is. So that's a pretty major indication of monetary policy failure. That's the second big problem. The third big problem was failures of adjustment. And this worked in two fundamental respects. Adjustment was massively asymmetric and remains largely asymmetric, though less so now. And some countries were fantastically much more successful in making the necessary adjustments to the shock. And if you take the extreme opposites, it's obvious Ireland is at one end and Greece is at the other. And the divergence between the two is perhaps even more staggering than anything else that has happened in the crisis. And I think lessons have to be learned of that. And the final problem is it took an enormous amount of time to work out any way of doing risk sharing during the crisis. The ECB played a big role. The ESM, as it is now, had to be created. And of course, we end up still with a massive overhang of debt. So that's the lesson of the crisis and the mistakes that were made. The Eurozone is now, my last area of discussion, the Eurozone is now coming out of this recession quite strongly. Greece is unfortunately still lagging somewhat behind, but the growth process is improving. Consensus forecasts consistently being upgraded. This is a really very good time to start thinking about what is needed in the longer run if this sort of mess is to be avoided in future. And I would suggest there are four essential elements if one is to operate successfully within this system without demanding too much. First, it's a simple reality that if you are going to operate in the Eurozone successfully, you have to match and benchmark your policy to Germany. Now, I think this is a horrible reality, and this is a discussion I've often had in Italy. So I constantly have discussions in Italy where Italian business people moan about how tough it is to live in the Eurozone. And my response has been absolutely consistent. It is, your country decided to join a Eurozone with Germany. We were not that brave. And you have to live with the consequences. And the consequences, if you have to benchmark the whole range of policy to Germany. The second issue for the future is managing aggregate demand. And I think the ECB has learned enormously and is likely to be much more effective next time than it was last time in responding instantly to the crisis. But that might not be quite so true if certain figures who are being mooted for presidency of the ECB actually end up as presidents of the ECB. If interest rates remain in the current territory, the next time round, there is a real risk that monetary policy will really be stretched to the limit. And the consideration of the use of fiscal policy will come back on the table. The third issue that I think lies to is how we handle the adjustment problem. And this is probably the most difficult thing of all, but we're going to have to, the Eurozone is going to have to think of a more symmetrical adjustment process. The simplest way of achieving symmetrical adjustment, and probably politically the most explosive, is for the ECB to pursue a monetary policy that maintains consistently inflation to target, and that will overheat Germany. That is its purpose. That is its purpose. That's how adjustment in a gold standard type system operates. It means that the countries with very large surpluses tend to inflate as part of the adjustment. If that doesn't happen, then adjustment is incredibly difficult. And the final area that has to be considered is better risk sharing in the system. And that means, in my view, far more of the capital flows have to take the form of equity than of debt. The intermediaries have to be much more robust, which means I think you need Eurozone-wide banks. You need a structure in which deposits are confidently backed. And the best way, in my view, is to make depositors senior creditors. That will minimize the drain on the fiscal support if there's a serious crisis. But there's a whole range of things that have to be done to manage risk sharing. And finally, when you get into real difficulties, debt has to be written down and written off, which would have saved a great deal of trouble. I think focusing on these areas and, of course, basic fiscal prudence, which comes back to my first point, benchmark yourself to Germany, is the only way to survive in the future within the Eurozone. Thank you for listening.